From the Groovy Mains Production Team Studios in the Netherlands. My name is Mixmaster G and welcome to this live stream. My mission is not to sell you as many apps as I can, no, my mission is to educate and teach you about collection management and conversion for DJs so you save yourself more time for the fun and creative part of being a DJ. For those of you who are not familiar with who I am, let me quickly introduce myself. I am a 55-year-old dude from the Netherlands. I had my first DJ residency at the age of 15, which means this is almost 40 years of DJ experience in the flesh. I am no longer an active DJ. I call myself a retired DJ, which means I might spin a gig every now and then, but nothing like what it used to be every weekend and stuff like that. However, I spend my days with writing apps, and you might know me from this particular app, the DJ Conversion Utility, which is right now the leading app when you want to go from one DJ software into another and maintain your queues, loops and other stuff. But besides that app, I write tons of other apps. Each Tuesday, I host this Ask Me Anything live stream where you can ask me all kinds of DJ tech related questions. The chat is open for everyone to participate in the live stream. If you want to tell something, if you want to say something, if you want to ask something, just throw it in the chat. First of all, let me say hi to the people in the chat already. AG Flow DJ, welcome to the stream, my friend. Good to see you every week. And the same for Daddy Doe. Good to have you with me this week. And you never know who will pop up later on, so we'll see that. It is midsummer, folks. It is midsummer in Europe. It is not as hot as it used to be in the past week. It is much better, but a lot of people are on vacation. A lot of people are doing stuff that is not really DJ related, having vacation out with the family, stuff like that. I am very, very busy with making tutorials. Why? Because as some of you might know, I have updated all my apps to work with the upcoming macOS Ventura. And during that update, I also changed the whole way you have to install my apps. It becomes much simpler and it becomes much more uniform and logical. However, it is changed from what it used to be. So I'm making tutorials for that. If you want a preview of any of those tutorials, I have the DJ Conversion Utility tutorial online right now. Now, if you have a license for the DJ Conversion Utility, if you are a DJ Conversion Utility user, then you can download the public beta for free, which is close to the finished product. As far as I'm aware, there are no bugs left and there is nothing I want to change in it left, but you never know who finds something, so that might change. But All the apps have public betas if you go to the message box inside the app, and let me show you how that works. Let me change the cam here. Now, I am notorious for forgetting to change the cam. That is something that each week during the AMA happens. And then I think you can see exactly what you see right now, the screen that is right in front of me. However, then I forget to change the cam and it is still like this. And I'm not aware of that. If that is the case, please shout it out in the chat box, because otherwise you might miss some stuff. Let me show you guys how you can obtain the beta. If we take, for instance, the DJ Conversion Utility. And let me see where I've hidden that one. There it is. The DJ Conversion Utility. But this works the same with any of my apps, by the way. So it's not only the DJ Conversion Utility. With any of my apps, you can do this. Let me double check, by the way, if my backup server or my backup drive is offline, because that will make things a little bit faster in the process. Let's wait for that to start up. There we are. This is the current beta that is out in public, version 5904. And you see this little box, the envelope symbol. If you click that envelope symbol, you get the message box. And within that message box is the download link to the beta. If you right click it, then you can open the URL. By the way, as I say here, there is a new installation tutorial. That is that new tutorial I was speaking about. If you right click that link and say open URL, it will open it in YouTube, and then you can basically watch the entire new tutorial step by step. It's a long one. I made it long on purpose because I want this to be the easy tutorial for everybody to follow, so you can just open it on your mobile device and watch it. I will put the link to it in the first comment under this AMA as well when I finished it, so you will find the comment there. While talking YouTube, last week I came off the stream and went inside the house, and all of a sudden my email box exploded, literally. What was the case? Mojax, and we all know Mojax. If you are here, then you know Mojax, DJ Mojax of BeatSource Tech, the godfather of DJ Tech reviews, reviewed the DJ Conversion Utility, and he crowned it his DJ Conversion software of choice. So I'm very grateful for that, and shout out to Mojax. If you are not following that man, please give him a follow. But he put out this raving review of the DJ Conversion Utility, where he also named it his preferred conversion utility of choice when going from, for instance, Serato to Rekordbox in his case. And it keeps spinning, so maybe the network is a little bit overloaded. So I'm very proud of that one. Thank you, Mojax, for that. And also, I will put that link in the comments below, so you can check it out yourself if you didn't check it out yet. Those two things I wanted to talk about. Then there is something weird going on with Firefox and downloading the DJ Conversion Utility for the first time. If you are a Firefox user, then what will happen is that Firefox will not take the DMG extension that the DJ Conversion Utility normally has. Let me see if I've got it downloaded here. Yeah, I've got it downloaded here. Let me show that to you guys. Look over here. Oh, this is the one I want. You see, usually the DJ Conversion Utility comes with DMG as an extension. What happens with Firefox is this, that it takes the, basically this, 507, for instance, the numbers behind the decimal of the version number, as the extension, which means that macOS doesn't know how to treat it. Right now, macOS knows this is DMG, so that's why you don't see it changing. But if that is the case, if that happens to you, then you have just a flat document symbol because macOS doesn't know what to do with it. If that is the case, just give it the extension .dmg. So just put .dmg behind it, then it will work. It is only with Firefox. I had two new DJCU users this week who had this particular issue, so I wanted to mention it. It's not something I can do about because it's a Firefox bug, but hey, you can easily circumvent it by putting DMG behind the name of it. So that I want to have covered as well. Then I got a question from a DJ who had troubles with the key notation in Rekordbox, meaning that some of his tracks came out with Camelot keys, while others came out with musical keys, and others again had something else, and it was kind of a mess in his DJ software, and his DJ software was Rekordbox, by the way. So let me open Rekordbox here and let me give you a little bit of a view what is going on there. I always mistake my various buttons, so sorry for that. Let's fire up Rekordbox. Now, when you use DJ software in general, there are basically two kinds of keys, and you need to wrap your head around this. The first key there is the key that is stored internally in the database of the DJ software, in this case, Rekordbox. And if we look at the tracks, let me see if the keys are there. There are the keys. Those are all in Camelot, as you can see. Those keys are not stored as Camelot keys in the database. They are stored as mostly numbers. They are usually numbers. Let's pretend that 1A is number 1, and 1B is number 2, and 2A is number 3. So they are just integers inside the database. Why? Because that makes things much easier for the DJ software manufacturers to change notation systems, because they only need to know, all right, 8A, for instance, is the A flat. So if I have an 8A, I can convert to 8 flat, and that is the same integer value. So that integer value can trigger what will happen. And you control that by, in Rekordbox, in the view, down there. And now I always have to look where they did hide it, because let's see where that is key notated. There it is. You can choose between the key display format in classical, which is it right now, and you see it immediately turning back, and in alphanumeric. So that is kind of different. And then you can say, all right, display the information that is in the database. So this is basically what was analyzed and stored inside the database, which is also a different one. As you can see, that is different than that, and this is different than that. So you see that those values can differ. Now, besides that value that is stored in the database of the DJ software, there is a thing called audio file tags. That is information that is basically stored with the audio information inside the audio file. Same as how artist is stored, title is stored, artwork is stored inside that audio file. And that tag, that key tag, can also contain entirely different information from what is displayed as a key right here. And in Rekordbox, you can even say, if you want the information from the analysis stored inside the key value. And now I have to, oh, there it is. Key analysis, write the value to the ID3 tag, which means write to the tag. Turn that off, unless you only rely on Rekordbox information, because if you don't turn that off, then it will override, for instance, your mixed in key values, or maybe your serato values, or your tracto values. So this is also a thing that is important. Now, here is the fun part. That key value, that value for a key, is just a string. It's just something you can type in. So I can, this is text as a key. And it will display that. You see, there it is. The key is, this is text. So it's just a text field. So that doesn't necessarily contain any valid key information. It can contain text if you want to, or something else. So that might throw off some other DJ software, and that is stuff that you need to take into account. If I change, for instance, the key right here, and let's do a little test here and see what happens. This is text, and we turn on that we want to write that to the audio tree tag. So now it's written. This is text. Sorry, I'm a little bit working with it, because I want to be sure that it's written to the audio tag of the audio file. Greg Perry, my friend, good to see you. Good to have you with me. I'm doing fine, thanks. Hope you are well too. Now let's see if we load that track. Let me find that track, and we can easily do that by show in the finder. Why is it not showing in the... Oh, it's a Beatport track. Oh, my bad. Of course, I'm taking a Beatport track. Why not? So let's do that again. Let's do that for this track, and then this is text. And then let's see that we can find that one in the finder. There it is, showing finder. So we just changed Lady Gaga, and you can see that the date that the track was modified, that because the key is written to that audio tag. Now let's load that up in Serato and see what is displayed as key. To be honest, I have no idea what is stored as key, and we run the risk that Serato want to override it. But hey, we are going to see what happens. So, Serato, why do you guys make it so hard just to make a small screen so I can drag stuff into it like this? And why can I not be in... There it is. And let's see if we can find a key there. I don't see a key anywhere. This is all Beatport stuff. Let me clear that up a little bit, because otherwise it becomes a mess. Is it deleting now? Let me start out with a clear, empty Serato collection, because otherwise this is going to take ages. Yes, I'm sure, Serato. Please, Serato, I have so many suggestions for you to make this stuff better. Start with not starting full screen. Give me the option not to go full screen. And second of all, don't keep asking me if I want to back up. I know when I want to back up. So if we can change that, that would make life so much easier. All right, we are back. Now I have to make this screen smaller again. Let's go to the old tracks. And it's still taking everything for... Oh, hold on. No, it shouldn't. I have no idea why it's taking that. But let's see, and now let's see if I can find the key somewhere. It doesn't show a key anywhere. Let me make a crate out of it, and I know what I'm doing, because otherwise I get lost very easily. There we are, BPM. And there you see already that indeed the key says this is text. So that non-key information was written from Rekordbox to Serato, and I'm not even sure. Okay, text. So I just put some extra information in that key field. Let me quit this and let's go back to Rekordbox. And of course, Serato want to be a bugger again. There it is. Let's fire up Rekordbox. All right, then we are back, and now if I go to the track again, it might appear that nothing has changed. You see, nothing has changed. That is because Rekordbox is not aware that something changed in the file. If we want to have those changes, then we have to reload the text. Reload the text from the file, and then you can see that indeed it changes. So if I go back to this view, and then you can see that okay, test is added to it. So, in short, that key value is not very reliable if you want to have keys, unless you are 100% sure that it contains the correct key. Otherwise, it can run into troubles. By default, I like my main collection not to write the Rekordbox text, because I rely on mixing key tags with the added zero in front of it. Lucky enough, most DJ software is intelligent these days, and that means that most DJ software knows that if there is a zero in front of a key value, that they can abbreviate that. Again, internally, that key value is not stored as what you see on the screen. It's usually stored as an integer, as a number. And the same is the case with your DJ gear. On your DJ gear, there is usually an option to say how you want to display the keys. And you can see that you can change that on the fly. And you can change that on the fly because it is, in the database, not stored as the thing you see on the screen. Let me show you that in a close up. Let me switch the cam to this. There we are. I hope this gets, I can make this visible on here, but we are going to give it a try. Right now you can see that this track is in 4A. This is an SE6000M. Now if I go to the settings of this particular thing, then I can say with the user settings how I want to have my keys displayed. Let me see if I can find that. Display. Not there. Safety. I always have to look where that stuff is stored. Sync mode. Cues and loops. Library. There you have. You can say Camelot, open key, flats or sharps. I can now change it to open key and you can immediately see that if I go back to the digits that it now shows 9M. Or if I want it flats for instance, so let's go back to the settings and let's make it flats, that it will change in F minor. That is because the value stored internally is not what you see on the screen. It's not 4M, there is an integer there and the machine knows which integer is connected to which exact key value. So you can very easily change that around. Now, let me go back to the view. There we are, 4A again. Most standalone DJ software has this option, has the possibility to set what kind of key system you want to display on the screen. Now, if I go back to my screen right here, and we go back to the export mode of Rekordbox, and I pick up a USB. Is there a USB inside? I think there is already a USB connected. No, there's not a USB connected. Let me format a USB drive quickly so we've got something to work on. There it is. Erase it. And let's do it. Why not? FAT will work with everything. And erase that one. Greg Perry, I see your questions, buddy. I will get to that in a moment. Fulcan G, good to have you with the stream. Welcome to the stream. And by the way, everybody else, if you've got questions, just throw it in the chat. And I will get to that in a moment. So now we've got the device prut. And within that device, we have the My Settings. And there we can say the various settings we want to have. So these are settings that it are taken automatically from the USB. Now let's see if there is something that we can tell that what kind of key system we want to have. I'm not sure if it is there with Pioneer stuff. It may not be there. And that means that it will then take anything that is inside the database. And as you just saw, if it is analyzed and recognized as a key, then it will be an integer and you can show what you want. However, if it is just random stuff, text stuff, then it will show that text stuff. And that is the reason why key displays can be messed up, because some contain valid keys, other contain nonsense or maybe a different notation of keys. And that will just be shown randomly, just how it is in first the text and then the database. So always make sure that your tags are correct, reload them if required. Make sure that the Rekordbox writes is not writing to the key tag. You can switch that off in the preferences as you just saw. And make sure that you basically have one key system for all your tracks, which is how I like it to be. Now let me turn the message from Fulcan G off. Now let's see what our friend Greg Perry has to say. What's your thoughts on mobile DJs, including all these add-on extras? I really do not understand. Just using uplighters, no other light effects, photograph, photo booths, fake trees, string lights. To be honest, Greg, I am a spoiled brat. I was always a club DJ, which means that usually there was a light guy in the venues that I spinned. Which means that I didn't have to bother with it. And of course, that is a very luxurious position, but hey, it is what it is. So I really have no opinion about that. But I can imagine that for certain events, at least uplights are a thing, but they also want the floor to be lighted up. On the other hand, I know from events where there is photography happening, that people are taking pictures, etc. They don't want lasers, for instance, and they don't want those spotty things because those can mess up with the pictures. But in general, I don't have an opinion about it. I really don't care. Light can, of course, make the party more lively, but as long as it is not a bright white light, then everything is fine with me. Craig Perry, you don't go into DJing to decorate rooms. It's about the music and the dance floor, yet so many mobile DJs are distracted and wrongfully focusing on these other things. Totally, I agree with you, buddy. I agree with you 100%. It's not the thing that the DJ should be worried about. On the other hand, if you are hired to also decorate the party, which sometimes happens, then it becomes your job. I see those tracks are VBR. Do you not use constant bitrate? I usually use constant bitrate, my friend. That is totally correct, and that is also what I recommend. But these were mostly tracks from Beatport, and actually it is just a random thing. It's just a random collection. We get to that, by the way, in a moment. But my preferred performance audio file format is indeed 320 kbs MP3s, constant bitrate, 44.1 kHz, 16-bit. That is what I like to use to spin. And I still have to find the first mortal soul who can tell the difference between my MP3s and the WAVs. So that's that. And I love to argue about that kind of stuff because so many people have tried to bring it to different thoughts, but hey, all failed in the end. Now, let me see what is happening here. Okay, so that about keys. So keep in mind, what you see on your screen is not necessarily what is stored in the database. And if you want to make sure that what is on the screen is stored in the database, then see what happens if you change the notation system. If the key changes with it, so if you see the key change when you change the notation system, that means that everything is fine and it is following the information in the database. If the key doesn't change when you change notation system, that means that everything in the key tag is recorded as text instead of a key. And that means that basically your DJ software doesn't know shit what to do with it. And you have to change that. So that is about keys and how you can change that. Another thing that I see popping up a lot this week is the question, I want to go from FLAC to MP3. However, I want to maintain my keys. How can I do that? Before we dive into that, let's take it three steps back so everybody knows what we are doing and why this is so important. Let me go to my record box again. There we are on record box. Let me create a playlist here. Let me empty that playlist and let's create just a new playlist. Create a new playlist. Test one MP3. Please. There we are. Test one MP3. And let's give it a couple of tracks. Let's analyze those tracks. It is for the sake of simplicity. Let's give it a key and let's do it for phrase and the whole kabang. Okay, here we are. I have analyzed those tracks. Now, what is important is that RecordBox links the queues and loops data to the exact file path of the audio file. So if we take the Hold My Hand track, I don't know that track, and I really don't care about it, but hey, let's give it a cue. So I gave it a hot cue. This is a cue. And let's give it a loop. We do this totally randomly, so hey, don't blame me. This is a loop. And let me show that track in the Finder, show in the Finder. There it is, that's, it's the Lady Gaga track. Now let me quit Rekordbox and let me just change the file path by changing the file name. Remember, the file path is the whole phrase of folders, subfolders, audio file name, etc. So let me make that visible that we all know what we are talking about, and I can do that very easily by creating an empty text edit document and then switch to text mode. And if I drag it in, this entire thing is the file path. And what I did is I added this little one in front of it. However, the folders before it are also part of the file path. So that whole phrase is the file path. If you change that file path, you will lose your cues. So if I go back to Rekordbox, and I try to load that Lady Gaga track, where is it? Hold my hand. It tells me, load error, the file could not be found. Fine, you think, all right, you cannot find that track. No problem, I add it again. So let me do that again. Where is my mouse? Something or somebody ate my mouse. Let's hope, fingers crossed, that it gets back, because otherwise I'm kind of at a loss. All right, Houston, we have a problem. I don't have a mouse. However, we have always a spare mouse. This is all working. No, the mouse is frozen. All right, let me get my other mouse. Always good that that kind of stuff happens in the middle of a stream. But lucky enough, I have another one loading. Like I said, I really have been busy with making tutorials, which means that those mouses can get empty. And who is ever watching what his mouse is doing? Now let's see if it's picking up. This mouse is not picking up either. Now things are getting a little bit more worrisome. This is all working. It doesn't click, it doesn't react. All right, that means a mouse with a cord. We don't let us down for nothing. But I'm still curious why that mouse is not working. But that might be a subject for a different time. Let me get my mouse up and running again. And this should always do the job. I'm still curious why the mouse is not working. Weird stuff is happening at the ATR studios. Let's see. Now we've got the mouse again. And that is working as far as I can see. And that one is not working. Let me see if it's not connected or something. Your wireless keyboard, PowerMac mouse, connect. It's not connected to the mouse at all. Can I still, yeah, I can still switch my screen. Some reason, hold on, there was a special tool. I always hate when stuff like this happens, folks. No, don't worry, we get back to the program in a moment. I'd always like to find out what is causing this kind of stuff, especially in the middle of a stream. So does it say it's connected now? Battery level 1%. That doesn't sound like something that would work, does it? So there is our problem. All right, I thought it was charging all the time, but it wasn't charging all the time, obviously. All right, so we got that one figured out. Batteries of mouses ahead. So I changed the file path of the file. Yeah, it's a mouse trap indeed, Greg. it's not a ghost in the Mac, my friend. It is just indeed the mouse trap. But hey, we are good again. That's one of the benefits of being a geek. I got this stuff all laying around. So hey, there's not much that can stop me from doing a stream. So right now it doesn't edit. Now if I load the track like this, it will load it, of course. It is not analyzed again, but you can also see that the hot cues, etc., are missing. That is because this track is on a different file path. Now, if I quit Rekordbox again and I switch back the file path, I remove that one in front of it. So the file path, let me show that underneath each other so you can see the difference. You see, the only difference that there is, the only difference between those two is this little one in the file name. But if I go back to Rekordbox now, then the new file won't load and the old file will load and has the queues and loops again. Basically what that means is, if you fuck with the file path, you are fucking with the queues and the loops. You can see there they are again, and this one of course doesn't load, but that's fine. So, and you can see that there's duplicate in, and one duplicate doesn't work and the other one does. So that is why file paths are so important. Now of course, if I change the file path of the track and I want to keep the queues and loops, what you can do is use the relocate function of Rekordbox, which is a powerful tool. Let me show that as well, because hey, I'm working on that anyway. So let's go to Rekordbox. And within Rekordbox, you can define where your audio files are at. So in the preferences, you can say under, let's see where that is. I think it was here somewhere, but I'm not entirely sure. Let's see where those are at. Why not? We have nothing else to do, right? Not there, not there, not there, not there. Browse, recording, library sync, others. I thought it was on the view, but sometimes it can take a while to find everything. No. Why can't I find where my audio file settings are set? Not there, I know that for sure. I know that for sure. Move to database. Oh, here it is. Auto relocate search folders. It is not entirely visible on my screen, as you can see. But we can see not in movies. I want to use a specified folder and then I have to change it. And I think that my tracks are in local test files. I'm not entirely sure. So let's give it a try. Now let me mess up. Oh, I did mess up that thing again. Yes, it is local test track, so that should be fine. So I specified in Rekordbox where my audio files are at, and you can use just the main folder, the root folder, the top folder of where you store your audio files, and after that Rekordbox will search deeper inside of it. So right now, if I load the Gaga track, it will tell us that it doesn't exist. You see there. However, if I right-click it, and you can do that with multiple folders or multiple files, you can save for all of them and say auto-relocate if it cannot find it. But for this instance, we know it is one. It did auto-relocate it because the exclamation mark disappeared. Now you can load it. And now it is known as a different file path than before. So if I change the file path back, let me show that. It cannot find it again because I changed it back, but internally it was now referring to the file path with the one in front of it. So this is important to wrap your head around. If you mess with your file paths, the only thing that can save you with keeping your queues and loops, etc., is maintaining your file paths or use auto relocate. If not, then you have a problem. So we just discovered, I just showed you how important file paths are in DJ software in order to keep your queues, loops, grids, etc. And that is of course the problem with when you change audio file types, because what you do is you go from a .mp3 file to a WAV file, or that is not very smart if you do that, but let's say from a WAV to AFF, which means you make a different file path, because track.aff is not the same as track.wav, so they have different queues and different stuff. Now there are some tricks you can do in order to make this work, and I'm going to demonstrate that with some FLAC files. However, you can only do that in DJ software, where you can import and export the information. So in Serato, for instance, you cannot do the trick I'm going to show you. You can do it in Virtual DJ if you know what you're doing. You can do it in Traktor. I'm going to show it for Rekordbox, because that makes the most sense. Rekordbox is the most straightforward thing, or the most straightforward software to do whatever I want to do. Now let me clean up my collection again. Let me take away that playlist. Let me call that playlist test one. That is fine, because that will save me time, but it's not going to be MP3s. And we may test one and make a second playlist test two. Two playlists, because I want to show you guys how what power is if you understand what you are doing, which is always a powerful thing, of course, but hey. All right, I've got some FLAC files here. Let me open that. And please, we put some FLAC files here. Yeah, that's okay. You already can see Rekordbox warning us about, hey, listen, not every CDJ understand FLAC files. So that is why, in general, if you don't know what you are going to play on, Greg Perry already covered that. Yeah, he was very kind. He was very, very kind. Thank you. That is one of the reasons why I don't like FLAC files as the default. Usually I would like FLAC files because it's a lossless compressed audio format, which means in theory best audio quality and still not taking all the space of it. Practically, you cannot use FLAC files in iTunes, and that is my collection manager, so already that is a minus. And not every CDJ understands FLAC files. Oh, hold on. Thank you, AG Flow. My bad. Here we are again. So back to Rekordbox. We have two playlists with the FLAC files in it. And like I said, I don't really like FLAC files because that might give you problems with certain CDJs. So what I want to do is I want to convert those FLAC files to MP3s. Now, before we do that, let me give some of the FLAC files some cues and loops. So let's set a cue there and let's set a cue there. That is the track echo. And then let's go to the playlist test 2 and bad memories. I don't know. I'm just doing something, folks. So let's give that one a loop too. Why not? We are at it anyway. So we gave two tracks, a couple of cues and loops, and we can easily identify those tracks because they are there and they are there. And they are, of course, in test 1 and test 2. Now, the first thing I need to do is export my collection to XML. XML is not the same as your Rekordbox database. XML is a readable representation of the information in your database. And the good thing is you can import and export that XML data in and from Rekordbox, which is exactly what I'm going to do. So export the collection. And let's name it Rekordbox. And then let's replace it. So that is done. And I didn't want to start DJ. Let me close this out. I quit anyway. Now, here we've got the FLAC files, as you can see. And like I told you, I want to make them those MP3s. However, we want to make those MP3s, but we want to maintain our cues and our loops and our grid information. Now, let me give you a warning. MP3s may have encoder shifts. There is a tutorial about it in my YouTube channel where I explain in layman's terms so everybody can understand what encoder shifts are, why they happen. What you need to understand is MP3s may have encoder shifts. Depends on how the MP3s are created. Some encoders have worse shifts than others, and others don't have shifts at all. Now, usually I like to use iTunes to make my MP3s because iTunes MP3s don't have encoder shifts, but I cannot use FLAC in iTunes. I cannot use FLAC files in iTunes. So for that reason, I recommend a program named XLD. Let me see, it should be there. There it is. It is freeware. You can, if you Google it, you can download it for free. Please give the guy who developed it a donation because he is doing the Lord's work. Within XLD, you can set the preferences. I will show you my preferences. So we go to lame MP3 and then constant bitrate, highest quality stereo 44 100 kilohertz. And you think, hey Mixmaster G, why not 48 kilohertz? That's better. Trust me, you might run into compatibility problems. 44 100 is what works everything. 320 kilobit per second. These are all off. That is how I make my MP3s. Now there is another setting in XLD that is important, namely the output directory. Where should XLD put the converted track after it converts it to your destination? I said it same as input, and in a moment you will understand why. But basically what it comes down to is we now have the file paths already pointing to the FLAC files. And if I put just the MP3 underneath there, the file paths will be about the same. The name will be the same. The only thing that is different is the extension. So that is why I find that very important. Let me highlight that again, because it is important. Output directory, same as input. All right, let's select those tracks and let's say to XLD, you can drag them on it. Let's see where it is. There it is. I hope that it is highlighted because I can hardly see it. That should do the trick. Well, let's see if XLD is working for us. Doesn't seem to be doing anything. Let's do it. Try it again. Why not? There we go. And you can see that it puts the same files underneath there as MP3. So I now have got the FLAC and I've got the MP3s. Remember, I created a Rekordbox XML. And let's visit that Rekordbox XML. It's in my documents folder and it is right there. Now, I like to use a program called BBEdit to do the things that I'm about to do. But you can do it from TextEdit as well. Don't do this from Microsoft Word or another word processor that adds paragraphs and works with stuff like pages and so. You cannot use that. You need to use a code editor. So I like to use BBEdit. I can highly recommend it. It comes with a 30-day trial. I sold it. So let's open that XML file. And inside that XML file is all the information about the tracks that are currently in our Rekordbox collection. Now, remember how important those file paths are. And if I just have a look at the file paths that I just created, let me show that, because then you see and understand what I'm doing. So let's take the pink track. There is the FLAC. But look at those are identical. The only difference is that the .FLAC has become a .MP3. So we can use that information to our advantage. If I delete this one, go here, and if I look for a .FLAC, hold on, we find it. Now, what I usually do is I take the apostrophe too. So if I just do a search and replace, I want to search for FLAC and I want to replace it with MP3. And we want that wraparound on for every track there. Then it just changed those MP3s, which means if I'm going to load this XML back into my Rekordbox, it will have the MP3 information. However, with that MP3 information is still the information of the cues and loops, because that is contained in this particular XML file. Now, there are several ways to get information inside a Rekordbox XML. The most straightforward way is this. Let me show that first. Go to your preferences in Rekordbox. You need to be in export mode. Then go to database, and then go to Rekordbox XML, and then we have to say browse, and we have to point it to the Rekordbox XML that is in our documents folder. That is the one I just edited in BBEdit. So that is the changed Rekordbox XML. Furthermore, you need to be sure that in the view, Rekordbox XML is enabled. Otherwise, you will not see it. There is no Rekordbox XML there now. If I turn it on, then it is there. And then you can open it. And inside there you find all the tracks. Now, if I ask which file this is, show information in the finder, it points to the MP3 because I pointed it to the MP3. However, this information is not yet inside my Rekordbox collection. There are two things you can do. Basically, because all Rekordbox versions but the Rekordbox 5.6.0 have the XML import bug, I don't recommend importing that information. But I can show you first how that works. If you want to import that information, you can just right-click on this and say import playlist. Then it says they already exist, because that is correct, and then it will override them. So basically it now overrides them, and if we look there, you can see that nothing has been analyzed, because those tracks have not been analyzed, the file path changed, so the analysis data is gone. However, if I analyze them right now, and I analyze them not for BPM and grid and for key, because that information is in the XML, I only analyze them for phrase, because you need to analyze them for something, and analysis is necessary to create a preview, then all of a sudden you see the queues appearing and the loop appearing. So that information came back from the XML. Now, the same with this one. If I just analyze those tracks, again, only for phrase. So what I did, I changed the audio type and I kept the information. You see that the test queues are there as well. Now you can see that they shifted. Now let me show that, because right now we've got duplicates in our collection. You can see that right here, and let me see if I can make that clearly visible. Yeah, you can see it right there. By the way, you can see, I don't know who said it, this is a bug in, or no, is it Fabier from the FLAC? I think it's FLAC. Yeah, all right. No. It's fine. Let's see. Yeah. VBR is because it's FLAC, and then pick up as VBR. All right. But if I load the same track from the FLAC, then you can see that the queue shift is real, that it does appear and that it is a real thing. This is the track Stay With Me. And this is the track Stay With Me Too. There you can see that it is aligned with it. And there you can see that it shifted. So that is a typical encoder shift, and that is just a matter of what kind of encoder you are using. And that's it is a constant. There are ways to correct for that, but this is how it is. So you still get those encoder shifts if you go from lossless to MP3, depending on the encoder that was used to create the MP3s. Now, if you want to take the FLACs away from the collection, what you can do is just sort it on MP3 and FLAC, and then select those, and then say, all right, remove them from the collection, and they will be removed from the collection. So now we effectively converted from FLAC to MP3 and kept our playlists and our queues and our loops, etc. So that is indeed how you can do this. By the way, I am thinking about creating a duplicate finder for Rekordbox in the tradition of the iTunes collection tool. So that used audio fingerprinting. But I'm not sure if I'm going to develop it. It's something that is playing in my mind. No promises, but if it comes there, you hear it first here. And there will be a beta of that. Now, let's see what is happening in the chat and what we have in the chat. Wafrin, good evening, MixMasterG. When a CDJ is paused, why does it sometimes start playing when starting a loop in loop mode and sometimes not? In general, if you are on a CDJ, everything that is stored in the hot bank, and the hot bank can be a queue and it can be a loop, if you activate that loop in the hot bank, it will always start playing. That is because CDJs don't have a gated function. They are always non-gated, which means the moment you trigger a hot queue or a hot loop, it will start playing. So that's the reason. Then let's see, correct about Mojax thing. We already covered that one. Why would DJs choose any other file format? Do you know any big named DJs who have or will only DJ with DJs with other formats? Which ones do they use and why? Most pros, it depends on their background actually. Most professional DJs who are DJs, use MP3s, high quality MP3s. However, we of course also have a lot of DJs that came from a producer background, and those DJs prefer WAV files because that is what they are taught. And it makes sense. If you are producing, if you are making remixes and stuff like that, then you want to be on WAV because you want to stay on the highest quality, especially if you are going to put effects on it and stuff like that. Then you need to be, or then it's best to be on WAV. Internally, Ableton Live, of course, converts MP3s to a lossless format. So all the DAWs will always first go to a lossless format and then perform the magic, and then you can export it the way you want it. So DJs are, or producers are, kind of wired to stick to lossless. But the DJs like me like to use MP3s, high quality MP3s, because that's more than enough. There is no PA system in the world where you can blindly tell the difference between a WAV and a good quality MP3 of the same track. Nobody ever that did it with my tracks. No, nobody could tell me in a blind Pepsi test which one was the WAV and which one was the MP3. And I think that's the most important part about it. So that's that. Just default loop mode. Not sure what you are meaning with that, Wafrin. You mean activating a loop by the encoder and then it starts playing? I never experienced that one. So I can always just set the loops with the encoder on the CDJs or just on the screen. And then the moment you trigger it from screen, by the way, it will play, I think. Oh, let's why not? Let's give it a try. I've got CDJ 3000 in front of me. All we need is a USB with some audio on it, and we can create that from the Prutz drive. So let's do that too. Let's drag that to the Prutz drive. Let's go. And let's drag that to the Prutz drive. Let's go. That is working. And let me get the cam over. CDJs have a loop mode button. Yeah, that's what I meant. But it doesn't always start playing from paused. All right, hey, we are going to have a look, Wafflin. Just a moment. Let me get the cam on the CDJs, the overhead cam. And there came a piece of plastic off. So let me put that right here. And let's, rather serious. Let me change the cams to that position and let's see what we got. That's me upside down. And this is the one we want. There we are. There we got the CDJ. Let me just make sure that that's zoomed in. And then let's take the USB that I just created and ejected. I'm sure I have a USB cable somewhere here that will fit it. There are three ways to put a USB cable in, and it was the third one. I hope this comes out a little bit readable, folks. So let's take that track, load it up. There it is. All right, we are paused as you can see. Now let's put it in front of it. Let's say, all right, we want to loop it 8. There we are. 2, 4. It's not starting here. It stays paused. I can change my loops without it starting at all, Wafrin. As you can see, this is all fine, and only the moment I hit it, it will start looping. And then, of course, we can shorten it. No, no matter what I try, it just stays fine, so. Yeah, it might be a Nexus 2 thing. Remember, CDJs are not a single thing. CDJs are a product category, and each CDJ has specifications that differ from the other, and even the firmware in CDJs can differ. But I cannot get it to play if it's paused, so I think you are triggering hotkeys. That is what makes the most sense to me, but I can be wrong. All right, folks, that means that I talked about everything that I wanted to talk about this Tuesday. I'll be back next Tuesday, of course, with Ask Me Anything. And you can ask me all kinds of questions in advance using Facebook Messenger or reaching out to me over YouTube in the comments. So that is whatever you want to do. If you like what I'm doing, then don't forget to give this video the thumbs up or to reach out to me over the socials. If there are any questions right now, please put them in the chat right now. I give it a little bit more time for anybody who wants to reply or want to say something or want to respond to something. And otherwise, we call it a day, and I hope to see all of you back next Tuesday, 7 o'clock p.m. Central European time. Great, Greg, to see you. Hope to see you next time as well, my friend. Always good to see you. Thank you all, guys, for watching. Let's see if we are on Twitch, if we are going to stream, or do I have a lot of Twitch watchers? No, I think it's okay. All right, people, thank you for watching. Mix